Can you hear me well? Yes? Dear friends, members of TSA, lovers of the beautiful colors offered by nature, I view this the ongoing research I am presenting as a contribution to the continuation the transmission of our pan-global heritage of colors. Archaeological research and archaeometry have been revealing how unfathomably ancient and elaborate humankind's quest for color and knowledge of the art of dyeing are, and how central to cultural identities they have always been in all parts of the world. How do we know with what colorants these ancient colors were obtained? Thanks to the considerable advances in dye analysis that have been made in the last 30 years, particularly high-performance liquid chromatography, HPLC, that allows to separate and identify all the different components of a dye, resulting in a unique fingerprint for each sample of dyed ancient textile. But how can we know now by what, how and by what technical processes these ancient dyes and colors were obtained? Only in rare cases can we rely on an unbroken transmission of traditional technical knowledge. I here show the example of indigo dyeing of cotton in subtropical Africa. Japanese type traditions, dyeing traditions on various fibers would also be very good examples. By contrast, in the industrialized societies of Western Europe, intensive chemical research and financial investment resulted in the discovery and massive adoption of synthetic dyes, leading to the demise of natural dyes and associated dyeing techniques. So how can we bridge the gap today? How can we get truly directly acquainted again with the colors that our ancestors managed to obtain from biological sources? By tapping the right kind of historical sources, the historian who speaks now, which are neither only the ancient treatises on dyeing, which give detailed recipes but do not show what their results should look like, nor the very rare documents, historical documents, illustrated with dyed textile samples, whose color is expressly mentioned, because they do not say how these colors were obtained. This leaves researchers with a still undetermined number of largely unpublished ideal sources. This ancient dyer's book names each color or nuance, giving detailed recipes and providing dyed samples of the resulting colors. I have started publishing some of them in French and in English. The aim is to promote proper recognition of the expertise of these creators of colors and to have the art of dyers recognized as a painter's art or any of the other arts of ancient civilizations. But I feel it's not enough to use the information as it's delivered in these documents requires some additional work, which may discourage many dyers and designers and prevent them from making full use of the endless inspirational potential of these extraordinary documents. In this instance, the palms which are mentioned in this very detailed recipe is the ancient palm of Ancien Régime France, so we still have to translate it into kilograms and other measurements calculate the proportions with the weight of the textiles you want to dye, and so on and so forth. In this instance, it's even worse because the Crutchleys were dyers who were recording their processes as they were dying along, and as you can see, it's very difficult to read, both because of the handwriting and the abbreviation. So, I know in the process of trying to make the world of color names and colors they reveal more easily accessible to artists, colorists, designers, dyers. It's a really the world of ancient and new color. That's why I'm always looking, you know, because I can't see anything on my yeah. So I'm doing that by preparing the publication of a series of workbooks in which colors are presented in the same order as in the source document to respect and highlight the technical rationale of the document and to extract the essential elements to reproduce the color as they are presented. So it gives the name of each color present in the source document and its translation. It gives a photo of the corresponding dyed textile sample. And then for each nuance, you'll have a table summarizing at a glance the process described for producing the color of the sample. Distinguishing the successive technical steps. The quantitative data provided by the document are converted into proportions calculated at the dry weight of the textile to be dyed. And what has never been attempted is that I'm going to try and give chromaticity coordinates for each sample, expressing them in the two related systems, CIALAB and CIALCH. Don't worry, I'm going to explain. In this instance, you see the result for one of the degrees of the scale of blues. And this is very important because these nuances, different shades of blues, were essential to, they were grounds to obtain the whole range of greens, the whole range of purples, and the major part of the grays too, and some browns. In that instance, you have the way a color which needs an indigo ground is presented. And in this instance, you see how a color that doesn't need an indigo ground is presented. Now I'm going to explain how you obtain this data. To obtain the chromatic specification of each sample, color measurements are performed with a portable spectral photometer. These measurements are, of course, non-destructive. And the spectral photometer that you see on the right measures the light beam's intensity as a function of its color, the wavelength. And it translates it into the CIELAB data. This is done with a standard illuminant and for a standard observer. So you really have the results of very objective comparisons. The CIALAB chromatic space, you see on the right, was proposed in 1976 by the Commission Internationale de l'Éclairage, International Commission on Illumination. It is the most widely used international system of specification for surface colors and particularly for the colors of textiles. In the workbooks, the LAB values are completed by the specification of colors in the complementary CIELCH system. You see how this system works. You have the axis of, the axis of grades from black equals 0 to white L equals 100. On the A axis, negative values of A are on the side of greens, and the red are the positive values of A. The A axis goes from blue negative values to yellow positive values. This three stimulus system allows to really situate each color, each nuance, in a unique position in this color space, and it's particularly interesting for its applications. Characterizing the color of each sample by chromatic measurements allows precise and pertinent comparisons between colors in sources preserved in different places. Mapping of individual colorimetric values is going to permit to propose color identifications and color names for all the samples in the very numerous recipes or sample sheets which do not give the name of the dyed samples present. It also, and maybe mainly, provides a precious tool to ensure the accuracy of the results of experiments to reproduce ancient colors with either natural or even synthetic dyes. And this opens a huge range of possibilities to designers, colorists, and dyers. I'm going to give a few examples of applications. In this case, we managed, thanks to this research, to compare the reds. You must know that what is called red by ancient dyers is a madder dye. They never call any red, except if they have been dyeing it with madder. So we compared the reds, madder dyes of the Languedocian dyers, with those of their contemporary English colleagues, the Crutchleys. Each dot and each bar represents an individual sample. And you can see that they are amazingly close in lightness and chroma. The Crutchleys being slightly more orangey than those reds of the Languedocian dyes. And all in all, if color difference measurements are done, which for this we have adopted the most exact equation, which gives a CIEDE 2000 difference of colors, we have differences inferior to 2, which is 2 is a limit which is accepted in industry. So we are under the differences that would be accepted today. They are better than most of today's dyes. Mapping of these individual colorimetric values will permit to propose color identifications, as I said. And for many recipes or sample sheets which do not mention the color. And lastly, I want to show you the possibility in the reproduction of ancient color this offers. We have started an international collaboration with friends and colleagues from all over the world, in Japan, in Mali, and here in Vancouver with Charlotte and team, to try and see if it was possible to reproduce the blues of the 18th century dyers with other sources of indigo and with other processes. Because, as you may know, the 18th century blues were obtained from wood vats to which indigo, exotic indigo, was added to Sudan. And of course, nowadays, coached wood is not processed any longer. So each of the collaborators started another indigo vat with a different source of indigo, a different source, a plant source of indigo, used in pigment form, or in paste form, or in coached compost form, in different biological vats, different processes. And the first results, you are the first to hear about that, show that it's apparently possible to reproduce these blues in a very precise way with all the historical known sources of indigo, including the Yoruba indigo from Africa, which certainly was never used by French dyers. So it's very encouraging. in that case, you know, I've taken the example of this light blue, which is which has a color difference from the original of only one. And one in this scale is the minimum perception of the human eye. So under one, you don't see any difference. At one, you start seeing a very, very slight difference. I'm concluding. The aim of the, well, this it's very important because, as I said, the blues are the basis of a whole range of different colors. And also because locating so precisely the chromatic spaces of these colors, the samples can be used as references for comparisons with many other color gamuts from different periods of history or different parts of the world. It's a kind of language which is being created between all the dyes and color civilizations of the world. Well, my conclusion is the aim of the the aim of the forthcoming publication of the Ancient Colors World Books is to give back their initial function and power to these extraordinary historical documents, their function as sources of technical information impossible to find anywhere else, as practical guides, and their power as inspirational sources for creating colors for our world, in the hope of preparing a rising tide of colors obtained from nature to compensate for the blackness, bleakness of our time. Thank you.